All right. Whitney extension theorem, 1934. This is the very beginning of the subject and the very beginning of many other things as well. So I thought I should explain. Now I warned the experts they're going to be bored to death. This is true especially of this lecture, more than of the most of the five. 99% of the lecture is giving the proof of the classic Whitney extension theorem from 1934 using Whitney's proof. Okay. All right, so recall the notation. So let's see. So F is a function in Cm of Rn, and if x is a point in Rn, jx of f, the jet of x of f, is the nth degree Taylor polynomial of f at x. Okay, I hope that compensates somewhat for the lack of clarity. Okay, so here's the formula for it, just the formula for the Taylor polynomial, and so jx of f belongs to this vector space script p, the vector space of all real-valued polynomials of degree at most m on Rn. Okay. And we're going to be working in Cm of Rn, which is the space of all real-valued functions on Rn, whose derivatives up to and including order m are continuous and also bounded, so that the Cm norm is finite. That's the sup over all points of the maximum of all derivatives from order 0 through n of the alpha derivative of f at x. Okay? All right. Now, I need to introduce another definition. It's something called a Whitney field. A Whitney field is simply a family that I'm going to write as P arrow, and it's a family of polynomials in this script P. So each one of these PXs is a potential Taylor polynomial, and it's indexed by the points X in the set E. So that's such a thing is called a Whitney field, and E is a subset of Rn. Sometimes it'll be finite, sometimes it'll be compact, sometimes it'll be completely arbitrary, but such a thing is a Whitney field. Okay. Now, Whitney asked the following question in 1934. Suppose you're given a Whitney field, P arrow equals the family P super X for all X in E, with E a compact subset of Rn, but otherwise just awful. Okay. So given such a thing, how can we decide whether there exists a function, capital F in Cm of Rn, whose jet at x is equal to the prescribed px for all x in E? So this is a notion of a function F agreeing with a Whitney field. Okay, and the question is, how can we tell, given an awful set E and given a Whitney field, how can we tell whether there exists a Cm function that agrees with the Whitney field? Let's compare that with the question from the previous talk. So the question from the previous talk was, given a function f defined on our awful set E, how can we decide whether there exists a function in Cm so that the function value f of x is equal to px for all x in E? So here, if you compare Whitney fields with functions, Whitney fields give us more information, but they demand more information in the answer, okay? We're told at each point x of E, not only a function value, but also a whole lot of derivatives. But on the other hand, to compensate, our function has got to agree not only with the given function values, but with the given derivatives at the points of E. So this question, this is a variant of the most natural version of Whitney's question. And it's maybe not instantly obvious whether it's easier, harder, equivalent, totally different, but in fact, it's much, much, much easier. And Whitney gave a complete answer to this question in 1934. So here's the first version of Whitney's theorem, okay? So suppose we have a Whitney field, Px, x in E, and it's defined on a compact set E, then the following are equivalent. First of all, there exists a function in Cm that agrees with the Whitney field, so that its jet at each point x of f is equal to the px for all x in E. And of course, what we want is precisely to decide whether A is true. Well, A is equivalent to B. And B is that for each order of differentiation, so for each multi-index up to order m, if you look at px with py and you look at the alpha derivative of that evaluated at x, that quantity tends to zero as the distance between x and y tends to zero, and this tends to zero more rapidly than this power of the distance between x and y. So that's a little o of absolute x minus y to the m minus absolute alpha. If you remember the reformulation of Taylor's theorem from the first talk, this little o reflects the fact that we can put in a modulus of continuity. So this really is just what you get from Taylor's theorem. And so the fact that A is equivalent to B means simply that if I ask you, well, is there a function f that does the job, then we could make the following experiment. I lock you in a room for half an hour and ask you to come up with all the necessary conditions you can think of. And then at the end of half an hour, I let you out of the room, and you will have come up with this. And Whitney's theorem says that's enough. If that's true, then in fact there is a capital F. Okay, so that's the first version of Whitney's theorem. But that's only for simplicity. Whitney's theorem actually gives much more precise information, which I'd like to describe. So here's the more precise version. So now we're given a Whitney field, but we're also given a number capital M, which plays the role of the number capital M from the first talk this morning. So suppose that the Whitney field satisfies these conditions. First of all, its derivatives. Look at P sub x. Now, this x is fixed, but this is a polynomial. So differentiate at alpha times and evaluate that at x. That should be less than or equal to this number m for all orders of differentiation up to m and for all points x in E. And then on the other hand, we have that if we take alpha derivatives of px minus py at x, that's less than or equal to this number capital M times distance x minus y to the power m minus alpha. And that's true for all orders of differentiation strictly less than little m, and for all pairs of points x, y, and e. And then finally, the same little o statement as in the previous version of Whitney's theorem. So a derivative of px minus py evaluated at x, we differentiate alpha times. Where did the pointer go? There it is. That goes to zero as the distance from x and y goes to zero, x and y staying in E so that these guys make sense, and that happens more quickly than this power. So suppose that these conditions happen, then not only does there exist an F in CM that agrees with the data, but we can tell what its CM norm is, namely its CM norm is less than or equal to some constant times M, where this constant depends only on little m and little n. Okay? And so not only can we tell whether there is such a function, capital F, that agrees with the data, but we can predict how big its norm will be. Thus we can compute the least possible inf CM norm of a function F that agrees with the given Whitney field, P, up to a constant factor depending only on little m and little n. Now, in fact, for C2 of Rn, with the C2 norm defined a little bit more cleverly than I defined it, so something equivalent, but equivalent for most purposes, but not for all, for a better choice of the CM norm, Erwin Legruyer and, oh God, what's his first name, Wells, found an exact formula for the least possible norm. It's not at all clear whether that's special to C2 of Rn or whether there's a version for CM of Rn. This is so special that, for instance, it works for real-valued functions, and it's not clear that there is any analog for complex-valued functions. But there may possibly be more exact formulas than we're aware of right now. All right, but that's all I'll say about that. I'm just going to talk about Whitney's proof, and his proof gives not only the existence of capital F, but he writes it. I mean, he proves the existence of an F by writing down an explicit formula for capital F. And furthermore, that explicit formula shows that capital F depends linearly on the data P arrow. And in fact, if P arrow is this Whitney field, P super X for X in E, then for any given point Y, if we want to know how F of Y is determined by the P X's, it's actually determined entirely by some fixed finite number of the PXs, so that for some number k less than or equal to a constant, depending only on which function space we're in, you can find points x1 through xk in E, so that capital F of y is determined entirely by p of x1 through p of xk. Okay? So there are not complicated formulas that involve arbitrarily large numbers of these p's or perhaps some integral of all of them, but instead there are, let's say, for any point y, if you want to know what f of y is, there will be 17 values of x in the set E, and you only need to look at those 17 values of at those 17 polynomials p of x1 through p of x17. Okay? So those are good features of Whitney's proof, and I'm going to make a phrase to incorporate this. I'm going to say that this capital F depends on p as a linear operator of bounded depth. Okay, so bounded depth means that to evaluate the answer at some point, you only need to look at the data at, let's say, 17 points. And that means that the depth is 17. Okay, is that clear? I'm sorry? K is equal to the depth, the best K, or maybe sometimes an upper bound for the best K is the depth, yes. Okay? And all right, how am I doing with the pointer? Is this the best we can do given the way the slides look? Okay. All right, so here's more about bounded depth. Well, never mind. Okay. All right, so now let me sketch Whitney's proof. And so the experts in the audience could give this lecture, I'm sure, as well as I could, or better. But for the non-experts, if you haven't seen the proof, I promise you it is beautiful. And if you don't think so, in the next few minutes, I'm seriously screwing something up, other than just making the slides. Okay, so there are going to be these main steps. First of all, we're going to take the complement of the set E, the world where we haven't specified the Whitney cubes, and I'm sorry, the Whitney field. We're going to break it up into Whitney cubes. So this is the first thing we're going to do. We have this set E. We look at Rn minus E, and we're going to partition it into cubes. Those are the Whitney cubes. The Whitney cubes will tell us geometrical information that will allow us to construct a partition of unity. That's the Whitney partition of unity. Once we have the Whitney cubes and the Whitney partition of unity, it is then possible simply to write down a formula for the extension, capital F, and then the last and the only ugly part is to check that it works. And so I'm going to skip most of the ugly part, but there's one idea in it which we're going to see. Okay, so those are the four steps. All right, so we're preparing to define Whitney cubes, and so we need a little notation. So here's a cube. A cube for me always means that the sides are parallel to the coordinate axes. When I say the word cube, I always mean a cube with sides parallel to the coordinate axes. And if the cube is called Q, then delta Q simply denotes the side length of the Q, and my pictures are in two dimensions for obvious reasons, but I could be in n dimensions. Okay? All right. So that's Q and delta Q. A little more notation. I'm going to multiply cubes by, let's say, 3. So here's the cube Q, and A is, in this picture, maybe 3. AQ is the cube whose center is the same as Q, but whose side length is A times that of Q. Okay, so I've drawn Q and I've drawn A times Q. Okay? Onward? All right. Another bit of elementary notation, bisecting a cube. So here's the two-dimensional version of that. Here's a cube Q. All right, it's two-dimensional, so it's a square. And we cut this square up into four subsquares, each of which is half the side length of the original square. These four squares are called the children of this square, and this square is called the parent of these four squares. Okay? And of course, in n dimensions, there would be 2 to the n children for each parent. Okay? All right. I think maybe that's enough. All right, now we're going to construct the Whitney cubes. So we're given our compact set E in Rn. And let's start with some great big cube Q0 containing E. In fact, let's say containing E in its middle half. And so this red thing here that I'm trying to color in with the pointer, that's the set E. And here's a cube Q0 that contains E in its middle half. Okay? And let's say that the diameter of this thing is 1024, 2 to the 10th. Okay, so that's our cube. That's the starting point of the construction. Now, to construct Whitney cubes, here's what we're going to do. We're going to proceed in steps. There's going to be a step 0, a step 1, a step 2, a step 3, and so on. For each integer, there's a step. At each step, let's say at each step I, we're going to produce a partition of Q0, the initial cube, into finitely many subcubes. The partition at step 0 is simply the trivial partition consisting of the single cube Q0 itself. So we don't divide it at all. The whole cube is just the partition at the zeroth stage. Okay. However, there's an induction to pass from the ith stage to the I plus first stage. What we do is we take the cubes that arise at the ith stage and we look at each of them, and we decide for each cube, do we like it or not? If we like it, we keep it, and if we don't like it, we bisect it. And that's how we form the partition at the I plus first stage. Okay, is that clear to the non-experts? Okay. Okay. So, all right. So how do we decide, given a cube at the ith stage, whether we like it or not? There's a very simple rule. So here, Q is a cube of the ith stage of the partition. We take this cube and we dilate it by 3. Remember, that means we simply expand it about its center, so its side length is multiplied by 3, but its center remains the same. We look at this 3Q, and we ask, is it disjoint from E, or does it contain some points of E? And the story is, if it is disjoint from E, then we like Q, and we do not bisect it, and instead we let it survive, and it enters into the partition at the next stage, stage I plus 1. And we then call that cube a Whitney cube. Okay? On the other hand, confidence. On the other hand, if 3Q contains some points of E, then we decide that we don't like Q, and so we bisect Q, and so at the stage I plus 1, Q is absent. It is replaced by its 2 to the n children, which I'm calling Q1 through Q2 to the n. Is it clear? All right, that's Whitney's construction. So now, what happens when you make Whitney's construction? Well, here, before we decide that, I have a picture which is particularly instructive since you can't really see it. All right, here again is our funny set E, and here's a cube Q, and the dotted cube, which is particularly obscure, but here is the dotted cube, and the dotted cube misses E, not by much, but it does miss E, so 3Q intersect E is empty, and so we like Q, it is a Whitney cube, we do not bisect it, and at the next stage, Q is still present. So that's a Whitney cube. On the other hand, here's a cube. Here's a set E. Again, I'll color it in with the pointer. There's the set E. Here's another possible way the cube Q could look. And now if we look at the dotted cube, we see that there are some points of E that belong inside the dotted cube. So this guy is not a Whitney cube. We don't like it. It was present at stage I, but we decided it was found wanting, and so here it is. Here's what we see at stage I plus 1. This cube has been bisected. So you understood that before. You understand it no worse now. And so there we go. Now, suppose we keep going through infinitely many stages. Now think about how we decide whether we like a cube. Once a cube arises, we don't care which stage it's in. Either 3 times Q contains points of E or it doesn't. So once we see a cube Q appearing in the partition, once we decide we like it, it stays forever through all stages. On the other hand, any cubes that we don't like will disappear. All right. So what do we get at the end of the day after we have done this construction infinitely many times? What do we get what are all the Whitney cubes? Well, the Whitney cubes have two basic properties. First of all, the Whitney cubes form a partition of Rn minus E. And secondly, the diameter of each Whitney cube is comparable to its distance from E. Let me explain why. So first of all, the Whitney cubes form a partition of Rn minus E. So what does that mean? It means two things. Any point of E is not contained in a Whitney cube. Any point of Rn minus E is contained in a Whitney cube. Let's take a point of E and let's focus on what happens through the various stages of this construction of the cube of the ith partition containing X. And if you think about it, the cube that contains X obviously gets rejected. It's not a Whitney cube. It's not the case that 3Q is disjoint from E. Even Q itself is not disjoint from E. It contains the point X. So it gets bisected. So from the point of view of a single point X in E just sitting there, what it sees at the various stages of this construction is it's contained in ever smaller cubes, none of which we decide to accept as Whitney cubes. And so sure enough, if X is in E, X is not contained in any Whitney cube. On the other hand, suppose X is in Rn minus E. Fix X and think of the world from the point of view of X. At the ith stage of the partition, as I increases, the cube containing X gets ever smaller. Its size eventually shrinks to, you know, arbitrarily close to zero. Sooner or later, it's so small that that three times it does not meet E. Remember, X is not in E, and E is compact. So a sufficiently small cube has the property that it stays away from E. And so, therefore, we get a partition of Rn minus E. I'm sorry, Q0 minus E. That's one of the many mistakes. Damn it, that you can see clearly. Okay, yes. Okay, yes, Q0 minus E. Thank you. Thank you for the correction. Okay. Okay. So, okay. All right, so the next point is that, yes, the distance from any Whitney cube, the diameter of any Whitney cube or the side length of any Whitney cube is comparable to its distance from E. Why? Well, let's think about how this cube Q became a Whitney cube. The whole cube Q0 that we started with was not a Whitney cube. 3Q0 is not disjoint from E. It contains E in its middle. So, okay, so our Whitney cubes do not arise at the very beginning of the construction. They arise somewhat later. Think of any particular Whitney cube. It arose by bisecting some next bigger cube. So we did not like that next bigger cube. We decided to bisect it. But we did like the cube Q itself, because it's a Whitney cube. Okay, so we like the cube Q, but we don't like its parent. Trying to make some joke about that. No? All right. Anyway, all right. So we do like the cube Q. That means that 3 times Q is disjoint from E. So the distance from Q to E is at least some constant times the diameter of E. On the other hand, we did not like the parent of Q. So 3 times the parent of Q intersects E, which means that the distance from Q to E must be no bigger than some other constant times the diameter of Q. So the diameter of Q is comparable to its distance to E. And those are the two basic properties of Whitney cubes. Okay, and here is a picture which, if you could only see it, would show the Whitney cubes. So here's our set, our red set E. And here's a Whitney cube which is not very big because it's pretty close to the red set. Here's a somewhat bigger cube because it's further away. And here's a quite a big cube because it's far away. But look here very close. And here very close to the set E, we have little tiny Whitney cubes. So imagine the world minus this red blob is partitioned into infinitely many squares because we're in two dimensions, squares. And as we get close to the set, the squares get teensy. And the size of each square is comparable to its distance from the set E. So this is a wonderful geometrical way to understand the complement of an arbitrary compact set. So it's sort of an n-dimensional analog of component intervals. How do you understand a one-dimensional open set? Well, it has component intervals. How do you understand an n-dimensional open set? Well, it has Whitney cubes. Okay. And here I seem to have written down the proof as to the basic properties. Okay, here are useful corollaries of the two basic properties. If two Whitney cubes, Q and Q prime, touch, then their side lengths must differ by at most a factor of 2. Don't worry about the fact that the factor is 2. If the factor were 17, it would be just as useful. And it's clear, because if you take any point in the closure of either of these, the preceding argument shows that each cube is comparable in size to the distance from that point to the set E. So of course the two cubes have to be about the same size. And from that you can immediately see that any given Whitney cube Q touches at most a bounded number of other Whitney cubes, where the bound depends only on the dimension. Okay? Does all that seem perfectly reasonable? Okay, those are the Whitney cubes. So now, we have now defined the Whitney cubes. Next, we define the Whitney partition of unity. So the Whitney partition, Whitney cubes are very nice, except that the indicator function, 1 on the cube and 0 off the cube, isn't quite smooth enough. And so we're going to smooth out those indicators and make a partition of unity. So the next object is the Whitney partition of unity, and it is going to be, we'll see what it is. All right, so for each Whitney cube Q, we fix a smooth function called theta tilde sub Q on Rn, which satisfies the following conditions. It's non-negative everywhere. It's equal to 1 on Q, but it's supported in a cube just slightly bigger than Q. We dilate Q by a factor 1.01, let's say, and theta tilde is 0 outside there. Now, how smooth can such a function be? How big can its derivatives be? And the answer is that the alphath derivative of such a function, the best we can do is that the alphath derivative of such a function is no bigger than a constant times the side length of the cube to the power minus absolute alpha. Okay, think about it. Think of even the one-dimensional case. You have a function that goes from 0 to 1 on a little interval of size delta. What can the derivatives of that be? Well, the first derivative had better, the function value can be bounded. The first derivative had better get somewhere about as big as 1 over delta, and that means that the second derivative had better get about as big as 1 over delta squared somewhere, and so on. These are the best you can do, and you can easily make these happen by simply starting with a function theta tilde adapted to the unit cube and then making some elementary translation and change of scale. So it's easy to produce these functions. Unfortunately, they don't sum to 1, and so we make the usual trick when constructing a partition of unity. We let C equal to the sum of all of the theta tildes. That means that if you're in the support of any theta tilde, notice the side length is then comparable to the distance. So all the relevant length scales here for a fixed x, all of the relevant cubes are about the same size, namely that. So therefore psi has the following properties. Let's see if I got them right. Again, psi is the sum of the theta tildes. It's greater than or equal to 1 on Rn minus E, because any point of Rn minus E is in one of the Whitney cubes, and then one of the theta tildes is at least 1, and the others are non-negative. Okay? So psi is at least 1. On the other hand, psi is equal to 0 on E, because if you look at the Whitney cubes dilated by a factor of 1.01, none of them contains any points of E. The derivatives of the psi are dominated by a constant times an appropriate negative power of the distance from the point x to the set E, because all the relevant cubes entering into psi in a little neighborhood of x have side length about like that. So that's the estimate that they satisfy, and there are a bounded number of them. How are we doing? Is it clear? Any questions? Okay. C cannot be smooth. It is, you're right, right. It is smooth except on the set E, where it is spectacularly non-smooth. Yes. Thank you. Okay. Any other questions or comments? Okay. or corrections. All right, fine. Notice that if we're in the support of one particular theta tilde, then we have this this estimate for the derivatives of the psi, because this is the only relevant length scale on over there. All right, and the psi is, I said, greater than or equal to 1 on Q. That's not right. It's Q minus E. There's another mistake. Okay. Well, now that we've found our functions theta tilde, and now that we've defined psi to be the sum of the theta tildes, we can simply define theta Q without a tilde to be theta Q tilde divided by psi. And that we'll think of these as functions only on Q0. That's the only place where we need them. So on Q0, except for E, this psi is greater than or equal to 1, and it's just as smooth as an individual theta tilde, and it's bounded away from 0. At points of E, this we would be dividing by 0, but at points of E, this guy is 0 anyway, and so we make the convention that on E, this theta Q is equal to 0. And so then we have found a partition of unity. The sum on Q of theta Q is equal to 1 on Q0 minus E. It's equal to 0 on E, and these theta Qs have the same smoothness as the theta Q tildes. That's the Whitney partition of unity. So that's a smooth partition of unity, which is natural for the geometry of the Whitney cubes. Okay, going once, going twice, lots of time. Okay, so now, from the properties of the theta Q tilde and psi, we easily derive the basic properties of the theta Q, so I seem to have written them down. Again, here they sum to 1 or to 0, depending on whether you're in E or not. For each Whitney cube Q, the support is in a slightly dilated version of the cube, a slightly bigger cube. And furthermore, the derivatives of the theta Q are satisfy estimates like that. The alpha derivative of theta Q at x is less than or equal to a constant delta Q to the minus alpha for all x in Q0 and alpha up to m. So those are the properties of the Whitney partition of unity. So now we have the Whitney cubes and we have the Whitney partition of unity. Notice we have only spoken about the set E. We have not brought in the Whitney field, P. The Whitney extension theorem was a theorem about Whitney fields. And the conclusion of Whitney's extension theorem is that there exists a function capital F. There exists this capital F under a certain hypothesis on the Whitney field. None of that has been mentioned. The only thing we've done is geometry having to do with the set E. So it's time to start talking about the Whitney field and the function F a little. And so that's the content of this remark. Come on. Wow, what can go wrong will go wrong. I know what I did. Charlie, do not place your finger where the light should be emanating from. Okay. We have now defined the Whitney cubes and the Whitney partition of unity. Now we can define the function f. Okay. For each Whitney cube Q, we pick a point, x of Q in E, as close as possible to, that should be to X. We pick the point of E which is closest to X, okay? It doesn't have to be the very closest. It could be as close as possible within a factor of 3. I don't care. But essentially, the closest possible point to X. All right. Now recall that we're given a Whitney field, P equals P super X. For each x in E. We want to write down a function capital F, which we hope will belong to Cm of Rn, and which will agree with the Whitney field. That's the object of the game. So I have to define for you the function capital F. Now, capital F is supposed to be defined on all of Rn, but it's enough to define it on Q0. Remember that Q0 is a big cube, and E is in the middle, one-third or one-fourth or whatever of Q0. And if I can define F on Q0, it's not rocket science to extend it to the whole world. So we're going to define F on Q0. And here's the formula. This is Whitney's formula. So what is F of X? Well, first of all, if X is in E, we're given a whole, not only a function value, but a whole Taylor polynomial, Px. So the function F had better be Px of X if X is in E. thank you very much. The serious problem is how to define f of x when x is not in E, and here's Whitney's formula. We use the Whitney partition of unity, theta q of x. We use this Whitney partition of unity to patch together local extensions, each local extension being defined on a single Whitney cube. And what is it? We simply pick the point x of q in E, which is as close as possible, or sort of as close as possible to x. And it comes with its own polynomial, px of q. And we decide that's our local extension defined on the cube q. And so we simply patch together those local extensions using the Whitney partition of unity, theta q of x. And there's our formula, sum on q of theta q of x times p x of q evaluated at x. That's Whitney's formula. Okay. Notice that as advertised, this function f depends linearly on the Whitney field. And furthermore, if I want to look at f at a particular value of x, I only need to know the Whitney field at some fixed bounded number of points, namely however many, there's an x of q here for every q such that x belongs to the support of theta q, and there are only a bounded number of those. So as advertised, the map from p to f is a linear operator of bounded depth. Okay, so now we have defined the Whitney cubes, we have defined the Whitney partition of unity, we have defined the function f. And now there's the slight, we have to work somewhere, and the work is, now we have to check that it works. So we have to check that this function f belongs to Cm, and we have to check that its Taylor polynomial at each point x in E agrees with the given px of E. And so that's actually almost entirely hack work. It's no fun, it takes effort, but it doesn't take clever ideas, it takes hard work. So I'm going to skip it, except for one idea. Okay. Notice that so far we have not used the hypothesis of the Whitney extension theorem. That comes into the hard work of proving that this f actually does what it's supposed to. There is one actual serious idea that needs to be explained. I have, 10 minutes left, something like that? Okay. One serious idea left to explain. All right, so what is it that we've got to prove? We've got to prove that f is in Cm. We've got to prove that its jet at x is equal to the assigned p of x from the Whitney field, and we have to dominate its norm by a constant times m. Okay. Now, maybe it would be good to recall the hypotheses. Here they are. The derivatives of each of the px's evaluated at x is less than or equal to this constant m. We have this estimate coming from Taylor's theorem, that the difference of two px's at x, so px minus py differentiated alpha times and then evaluated at x is less than or equal to this number m times the power of the distance from x to y when x and y belong to E, and then this little o statement that I'm going to skip. Okay, now here's the key idea. There is a dangerous point. Suppose that I look at this function, together with the slide, maybe I will tell you the key idea before I tell you what it's for. Okay. Let's look at a particular point x not in E. Let's say, all right, then it belongs to one of the Whitney cubes. Let's say it belongs to the Whitney cube q hat. All right, now here's our formula for f. It's a sum over all q. But I'm interested in how this thing behaves near the point x, which belongs to q hat. And therefore, I'm going to write it this way. So now I'm curious, is this formula legible or should I read it? It's fine? Oh, good, something went right. Okay, so f is equal to this p x of q hat plus a sum on q of theta q times these differences. Now, why is it true and so what? Why it's true, well, what have I done? I've added this term, but I've also added this term. And they cancel because the theta q's sum to 1. So at least it's true. Why do we care? Well, I want to estimate the Cm norm of q0. That means that I'm going to be differentiating f up to m times. Right? Let me go back and look at the formula. Look at this formula. Suppose I differentiate that guy m times. Some of the derivatives will hit p, some of the derivatives will hit theta. Now these thetas are defined on cubes q, many of which are tiny. If this is a tiny cube, a 15th derivative of theta of q is enormous. How about this p? I may differentiate it a few times as well, or not, but it's clear there's no reason why it should be small. It may vary smoothly, but it's not going to be small. So this is enormous, and this is not small. And so when I take the derivative of a product like this, I'm setting myself up for disaster. Okay. However, suppose that I look at this. Well, this is a polynomial. If I differentiate this, what can go wrong? And in fact, I'm given estimates for this polynomial as a hypothesis of the Whitney extension theorem. So now I've got to look at products like this. Aha, suppose that Q is very small. This derivative is going, if Q is tiny, then the derivatives of this theta are, the derivatives of this theta will be big. But notice here I'm looking at x of q and x of q hat, and I'm only interested here when x belongs to the support of theta q, and by definition, x belongs to q hat. Okay, so these cubes touch, maybe they even coincide, and so the distance from x of q to x of q hat, if you think about it, is dominated by the only length scale in the problem at the moment, namely the diameter of the cube q. So that's good. This is less than some large power of the diameter of the cube q. And here, every time I differentiate, it gets bigger by a power of the diameter of the cube q. And so this formula, unlike the preceding formula, has a chance to work. Okay. And so, yes, that's the point of these slides. So here's the crucial point, and there's some simple geometrical proof, which I'm going to skip because I'm out of time. Oh, well, maybe I'll look at the picture. Here's Q, here's Q hat, here's X. Here's X of Q, which is as close as possible to Q. Here's X of Q hat, which is as close as possible to Q hat. Aha, the size of this cube is comparable to its distance from the set E, so this distance is comparable to that diameter. Similarly, this distance is comparable to this diameter, and this guy is about as big as that guy, so there's only one length scale in the problem, and so the distance from here to here is at most a constant times the diameter of q hat. So that's the proof. Okay, and here are some estimates, which I don't have time to explain, but the result is good news. Okay. Okay, and so we can use that to show that the derivatives of the function capital F don't blow up as we approach the set E, and that's a crucial step in Whitney's extension theorem. And so that's the only remaining idea. All the rest is hack work, and so you haven't seen the hack work, but trust me, you've seen the essential ideas in the proof of Whitney's extension theorem. Okay, now, all right. Remember, Whitney's theorem completely answers the question, which is not exactly the one we really want to ask. Namely, it tells us whether we can find a CM function that agrees with a given Whitney field, whereas we really want to know whether there is a function, a CM function, that agrees with a given function, little f. It's a different question and a much easier one. However, despite that, Whitney's theorem is extremely useful for what I'm going to call the real problem, you know, the problem for functions. It contains numerous lessons for the real problem and for analysis generally. And so very quickly, I'd just like to run through a few lessons from the proof of the Whitney extension theorem. And so I'm going to present these in ascending order of importance, starting with some minor remarks and ending with some asserted great thing. Okay. Lesson number one, we will be interested in products of the form factor 1 times factor 2, where derivatives of factor 1 are big. They're like they're negative powers of some small length scale delta. But that's OK, because we compensate with factor 2. And factor 2 is small. And every time you differentiate, well, it's not quite as small. And that's what happened in the proof of the Whitney extension theorem. And that will happen in other arguments as well. So That trick is a very useful trick. Okay. The second lesson, is Whitney's extension theorem for. What's happening? Okay. Whitney's extension theorem for finite sets. Okay. The special case in which the set E is finite is actually of interest for the following reason. Suppose that I want to extend. Thank you. Suppose I want to extend a function defined. Well, let's see. Actually, wait for it. First, here it is. Okay. Here is Whitney's theorem for finite sets. We have a finite set. We have a Whitney field on that finite set. It satisfies these estimates. It satisfies these estimates. Remember, there was a little O statement as the distance between two points tends to zero. If you have a finite set, it's not so easy for the distance from between two points to tend to zero, so that's simply gone. And so this is the version of Whitney's theorem. Of course, if there are finitely many points, of course we can find an F in CM that agrees with the Whitney field, but this guy tells you how to compute its norm. Okay, and all right, I'm going to skip a few slides, but please trust me, if you think about Whitney's extension theorem for finite sets, what you discover is that there is a simple linear algebra problem, minimizing a quadratic function on an affine subspace of some Euclidean space. There is a simple linear algebra problem whose solution tells you the norm for the real problem being to extend a function. Okay, so given a function on a finite set, let's say with 17 points, what is the best possible CM norm of a function on our end that agrees with some given function on 17 points? That can be understood by using Whitney's extension theorem for finite sets, and it's reduced to linear algebra, and I don't quite have time. The point is that you're not given a whole jet, you're only given a function value, but the derivatives that make up the rest of the jet have to be something, and so you optimize something over those unknown derivatives. And if there are only 17 points, there are only a few variables over which you're supposed to optimize, and you can reduce it essentially to linear algebra. So 17 points are not without subtlety, because, for instance, of the 17 points, maybe 8 of them are very, very close together compared to all the rest. And among those 8, maybe 5 of them are closer together than the other 3. And among those, there's a little cluster of 3 and a little cluster of 2. And within the little cluster of 3, 2 of them are closer, and so on. And there's more subtlety than that. But it can all simply be done by the Whitney extension theorem for finite sets. So now I hope that I have, let's say, 3 minutes left. Is it true? Okay. Okay. Right. All right. All right. Fine. All right. But now here's the big lesson, which conveniently you can't see because it's written like that. The big lesson from Whitney's extension theorem is the idea of the Calderon-Zygmund decomposition. I'm just going to talk. What is the Calderon-Zygmund decomposition? In the Calderon-Zygmund decomposition, we start with one cube, typically a big cube that contains whatever situation we care about. And we do the same thing as before. We look at each cube, and we decide whether we like it or not. And if we like it, we keep it, and it's a Calderon-Zygmund cube. Before I said it was a Whitney cube. If we don't like it, we bisect it. And then we keep going, okay? And we repeatedly bisect until we arrive at cubes, if any, that we like. Now, Whitney gave a particular rule, namely, if you look at a cube Q, dilate it by a factor of 3, does that intersect the set E or not? That's our rule for whether we like the cube Q. Well, that's Whitney's rule. Calderon and Zygmund later gave a proof of a very important thing, never mind what, using a different rule, but using the same idea of keep a cube if we like it and bisect it if we don't like it. Okay, you can give any rule you like. For each problem, you might think of what is the appropriate rule, and you can try to make such a decomposition and hope that somehow it helps you, and it will help us in understanding interpolation of data. The important point to remember is that given any Calderon-Zygmund cube, you like it, but you don't like its parent. And you can get information from both of those. It may happen, it will happen, I mean, it didn't happen for Whitney, it didn't happen for Calderon and Zygmund, it will happen for us, that any sufficiently small cube we will like. And so our construction, unlike Whitney's construction and unlike the construction of Calderon and Zygmund, will eventually stop. And we will have a partition of our big cube into a finite number of smaller cubes. And it will tell us something useful about the problem. What? Well, stay tuned. Okay, that's it. Thank you.